Warning: The Savage Nation contains adult language, adult content, psychological nudity. Listener discretion is advised. And now, America's most exciting radio talk show, The Savage Nation, home of borders, language, culture. And here he is, winner of the National Radio Hall of Fame Award, Michael Savage.
Davy Jones of rum and gold and wenches bold. You had your last fill, Billy Bones.
Welcome to the Savage Nation. Good morning to you, Billy Bones. Keep playing it, Robert.
Good morning to you, Billy Bones.
I want to just play this
Billy
song
Bones.
By Skip Henderson.
Good morning to you, John and Billy.
A local artist in the Bay Area.
I've
sailed the salt sea, that's why. It's a great song, and since I dreamed of Bones the other day, I know you can't play it and have me talk, I get it. So just play the music, it's better than me.
Today,
everyone sing along. It's an old Irish sea song. Oh, it said wenches. Sorry, we have to strike that from the record. See, everything masculine and European is offensive to some moron. Yesterday, I did a show that was very popular. I know it was by your response. I made a list of offensive New York City neighborhood names that must be removed because they're offensive to the communists. Because the stupid mayor, de Blasio, a Sandinista lover, wants to remove statues of Columbus and such and rename Columbus Circle, I guess, to Sharpton Circle or something along those lines. Maybe, something even more offensive than Al Sharpton he can pick and tell us that it's not racist. But so I said, went down a list of New York neighborhoods and cities, city streets, that are offensive and must be changed, such as, I said, Broadway. It's sexist, has to go because it's an archaic term for women. The Meatpacking District. Do I have to say it's clearly a homophobic slur? Time to go. Queens, another gay slur. Diker Heights. It's offensive to tall lesbians. Upper and Lower East Side have to go because we can't imply there are different classes. We're all equal, right? There's no upper and lower anything. Now, if you live in Flushing, New York, it's unfair to people in other countries who do not have indoor plumbing. And if they've just come here from Somalia, for example, they may feel oppressed by the name of the city, Flushing. So that has to go. Fordham, gone, has the word ham in it, offensive to Muslims. Crown Heights suggests royalty, which we all know, well, slaves, royalty. Chinatown, racist against Asians. Now, Little Italy is offensive not only to Italians, but to short people also. It has to go. Stuyvesant Town, racist Peter Stuyvesant stole Manhattan from the natives, has to go. You get the picture, right? Do I have to continue? It's on michaelsavage.com. And finally, we get to Ozone Park, offensive to environmentalists, has to go. Little Neck makes fun of a person's deformity. I think that's very funny. Jim Verde created most of them yesterday. He wrote a new list for us today. If you care to join the fun, the phone number here is 855-47282. We're also going to talk about much more serious things. I think it's more serious to talk about the death penalty. Because here in California, we have a thing called a ballot initiative. You know, where they make believe that we have the power to decide things, the vermin who run the state, the filth in black robes. Well, we voted. We did it legally. No one ran anyone over. No one pulled out a gun. No one pepper sprayed. Like good little sheeple, we went to the ballot, to the voting box, and we voted, and we said we want the death penalty speeded up. If you've been tried and convicted numerous times, we want you fried within or gassed or injected within 5 years. Because the average tenure on death row in this sick state of ours is 20 years. Now, there are lawyers who made a fortune off death penalty cases. You got to understand, there's a lot of money involved in the appeal of death penalty cases. They don't all do it because they have any sympathy for them at all. This is a full-time job for many of these left-wing loser lawyers who can't get a job in a regular firm. All right, so we voted, and it says that the state of California shall make sure that those convicted of crimes and found guilty and gone through appeals shall be executed within 5 years. So a few stinking judges on the California Supreme Court, left-wing goombas, really bad ones, really bad. You know what the word elitist means? Filth like this. These filthy, dirty bums on the California Supreme Court, there's no other word to describe them. They're the lowest of the grubyon lawyer who politicized and got themselves a stinking job in the Supreme Court. You know what they said? They said the word shall is not a directive, it's a suggestion. We shall decide what it actually means. This is what happened yesterday. So today we're going to talk about the death penalty for and against in the Savage Nation as well. And if you have any offensive names that you think should be changed, we'll work that in on the program. I have some new names that Jim put together today. Paradise. Now, there's Paradise Valley in Arizona. There's Paradise Drive in California. There are many cities and states and towns with the name Paradise in it. And I think all references to Paradise obviously have to go, because Paradise as a word is offensive to Islamofascists who believe that they need to kill to get there. And for you to be living in a place without having killed, do you realize how offensive that is to the Islamofascists in the world? Haight-Ashbury has to go. There's no room for hate in America. Russian Hill, offensive to Clinton supporters for obvious collusion with Trump. Russian Hill has to be stricken. Tenderloin District, that is clearly offensive to vegans in San Francisco. Now, in Oregon, you've got Mount Hood. Do I have to tell you that that's an obvious reference to the Ku Klux Klan? That the mountain itself, Mount Hood, was named for the Ku Klux Klan? Don't you see that? Can't you see the world through the eyes of the girls who go to college today? Great Smoky Mountains, goner. Because why? It's insensitive to those suffering from secondhand smoke inhalation. You don't want to encourage smoking, do you? You're going to take your kids to see the Great Smoky Mountains? The kid will say, well, mommy, what's smoke? The White House, do I have to tell you why that has to go? Old Faithful. Now, that's a tricky one because it implies that we're judging by age. And I think Old Faithful has to go and be changed just simply to unfaithful. Notre Dame has to go because it's a slur against women. It's an old slur against women. Notre Dame, are you kidding? Hershey, Pennsylvania has to go. It may be offensive to diabetics. Bourbon Street. Do I have to tell you that's insensitive to those afflicted with alcoholism? So get rid of that. You see where this is going, Mayor de Blasio? Mayor de Blasio, if you had any brains, well, I would say his brains are equal to his conscience, okay? They're about equal. Now, I'm saving the best for the last of this opening, which is Nancy Pelosi. She's a gift that never stops giving. She gave a speech last night that shows she is clearly senile that you have to listen to. I want you to listen carefully to Nancy Pelosi in number two.
My hope is that the Park Service would not allow these elements to use a national park to spew forth their venom. The Constitution does not say that a person can shout, yell wolf in a crowded theater. If you're endangering people, then you don't have a constitutional right to do that.
Okay, so yelling wolf in a crowded theater is not allowed, according to Nancy Pelosi. How about yelling Pelosi in a crowded Congress? Nancy, it says... It doesn't say you can't cry wolf. What does it say? It says you can't cry fire in a crowded theater, Nancy. Fire. Fire, Nancy. It's not wolf. This is what's running the city and what's running the country. Can you believe this? Now, speaking of Ms. Pelosi, there was an interesting article today. I lost it already. Oh, here it is. She said you can't shout wolf in a crowded theater. We're trying to help her along here. Apparently, the Daily Wire found something very embarrassing about Pelosi's father. He once dedicated a statue to Robert E. Lee. That's right. House Minority Leader Nancy the Wolf Pelosi's Sins of the Father speech have come back with a vengeance. After calling the Confederate statues in the Hall of Congress reprehensible, mind you, and demanding House Speaker Paul Ryan order the removal, revelations have appeared that her father once actually dedicated a statue to former Confederate General Robert E. Lee. According to Red Alert, Pelosi's family history shows that her father, Thomas D'Alessandro Jr., publicly endorsed bigotry by her own definition. When Mr. D'Alessandro dedicated a statue to Confederate General Robert E. Lee while mayor of Baltimore, in a speech dedicating the statue, Pelosi's father hailed Lee and Confederate General Stonewall Jackson as a symbol of unity and a source of our inspiration. D'Alessandro said the following, and this is Pelosi's father, "Today, with our nation beset by subversive groups and propaganda which seeks to destroy our national unity, we can look for inspiration to the lives of Lee and Jackson to remind us to be resolute and determined in preserving our sacred institutions. I only wish that Mr. D'Alessandro Jr. was speaker, former Speaker of the House, instead of his daffy daughter. Wouldn't that be nice?" Now, the very same statues that Mrs. Pelosi's father once lauded were removed last week by Mayor Catherine Pugh. And the last name is not made up, but that's her name, Catherine Pugh. Well, now Pelosi is demanding the statues in Congress have the same fate. She is also leading the charge that President Trump censured because of his response to the white nationalist rally in Charlottesville. I rest my case. But this is going to get worse before it gets better. Phone number here is 855. I don't know the number. 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-7282. Here's a little side note while we're waiting for your calls. You know the guy who's running France now, the Rothschild Bank frontman, France Macron, who defeated the wonderful right-wing woman who could have saved France from the Muslim invasion? Well, France's Macron spent 24,000 pounds, no, 24,000 euros on makeup in 3 months. You talk about fake politicians. President Emmanuel Macron's office has confirmed reports the French leader spent $30,000 on makeup during the first 3 months in power and says it's trying to find a cheaper alternative. But it gets even better. Remember the socialist dunce who ran France before him? Hollande, remember him, that dunce? Macron's makeup expenses are lower than those of predecessor François Hollande, who paid a full-time makeup artist 10,000 euros monthly. You talk about excess. It always comes worse from the left than the right. And now let's go to the callers on the Savage Nation. See if you can top Jim's and my descriptions of cities and counties and states and names that have to go. And I want you to call on a more serious topic, which is the death penalty. Because I said before, we in California, we did it the legal way. We didn't harm anybody. Some people put together Proposition 66, which says it's an expedited death penalty initiative. That's what it was, which means that they have to fry them after 5 years that they're on death row. So these judges on the state Supreme Court, so-called in California, struck down a voter-approved mandate to decide all capital cases within 5 years. The lying, stinking, left-wing fanatical judges ruled yesterday that the timetable set out in the November initiative, Prop 66, would be unconstitutional interference with their authority if taken literally. The ballot language was clear. It said the court shall resolve death penalty appeals within 5 years of sentencing, more than twice as fast as its current pace. Do you know what the filthy judges did? They said it's only a recommendation to work faster. Now, you know, and I know, that a lot of the violence in America is occurring because people feel powerless. But that powerlessness is not limited to those on the left. The feeling of powerlessness is increasing on the right and amongst the middle as well. And these judges are making it much worse. California has the nation's largest death row with nearly 750 convicted murderers, half of whom have been there for at least 20 years. And appeals of death verdicts now take more than 20 years to resolve on average. Can you believe this? There's no feeling whatsoever for the victims of these murderers. These judges have to go. In fact, the whole legal system has to go because our legal system is corrupt from the top to the bottom. You know it, and I know it. If you think this is the only example of corruption in the legal system, I can give you 50 others. I'll be right back.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282. Savage.
The Savage Nation is sponsored by Swiss America, the only company I trust with my financial future. Call 800-289-2646 or SwissAmerica.com. Sung by white supremacists, by the way.
Du hast mich.
It's a German group. Maybe the German language should be made illegal. I think it scares a lot of people. You have not. To have and have not. It's actually a brilliant poem. Just play it to the first stanza. I like this song. A lot of people freak out from it. Hear the song, they see stormtroopers. I don't. I see rock musicians. What would Woody Allen think if he heard this? What would Larry David think? This song? Psychiatric care immediately. Bellevue Hospital. Immediate. An ambulance. A 911 job. WABC Rich, line 3. Go ahead, please. Which street needs to go? Or which name?
Well, Michael, I was thinking of Man's Best Friend and the canine. There are many canine names that are offensive. Shepherd. Offensive to everybody who doesn't like Germans and to the Christian religion in the shepherd with the biblical reference.
Oh, you mean if it's a shepherd of any kind, it refers to Christianity, so that might offend Muslims. It could offend Hindus. You don't know.
Yes, and I think even bigger than that is the border collie. Offensive to globalists and illegals.
Did you work on this all night?
Michael, I actually had a dream last night similar to your skeleton.
Here I go. I'm influencing psychosis across America. What was your dream?
3 o'clock in the morning, I popped up, and I'm thinking about you and the skeleton, and I'm coming up with these names of offensive things that need to change. Knowing you're a dog lover, I'm a dog lover, it was just these things started coming to me.
Well, what does my skeleton have to do with it?
It was just a conversation that you had yesterday. When I went to bed last night, I was thinking about it, and my own dreams came to me.
I'm pretty sure I know why I had that nightmare that I was just a skeleton with no flesh. And I know what it was. It was Trump's speech. So freaked me out, I felt I was stripped to my bone, to my bones. That's when he had like the 5 different Trumps in Phoenix. That's when I felt stripped down to my bones from it.
Yeah,
I guess I'm not allowed to say. I'm not allowed to say that. It may be offensive to the MAGA people. MAGA. MAGA. They can wear the MAGA hats. MAGA. I think we should get 1,000 Trump supporters in MAGA hats to go down to Houston tonight when the storm is coming. Maybe if they stood there chanting at the storm and went, MAGA, they could scare it away, make it turn somewhere. All right. You know, it's a tough thing here. This is like standing up there on a stage and you don't even know if... Forget about an audience that's not laughing. You don't even know if they're even still there. That's the beauty of talk radio. You want to know what fear is? I don't have it. Because if I did, I couldn't be in this business for one cent. Second. You know, there's a show called Dying Up Here about comedians in the 70s. Great. A little audience, 50, 100 people. Well, try millions of people who aren't even there and see what that does to you.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE. 855-400-7282. Savage.
All right, welcome back. It's Friday. You know what I mean? Lighten up a little bit. Now, you know, if I really wanted to get angry, I would say that we should start a recall petition for the California State Supreme Court justices who overrode the ballot initiative that the people passed. That should be the next ballot initiative. So then let's say it passes after 2 hard years, and it says the 3 judges who overrode the ballot initiative the last time shall be removed. So then it goes back to these 5 stinkers again, and the same 3 say, well, shall is only a suggestion, not a directive, so we'll stay on a little while longer. Well, now you understand how revolutions occur. You understand what's going on in this country. You think that only Antifa is angry? You ain't seen nothing yet. You have not yet seen the average law-abiding, tax-paying American rise up. He will. I'm telling you right now, it's going to happen if this keeps up. The more that the rights of the middle class are stolen, the more that our culture is spit upon, the more the statues are pulled down, the more that the children are taught that being white is evil. I'm warning you, you're stirring up a civil war. And, of course, that's why these people are doing it. They want civil war. In 2014, I published a book called Stop the Coming Civil War, Not Start the Coming Civil War. And I warned America that a civil war was brewing. Obama had spent the years before that stirring up race hatred, class hatred, anything he could do to stay in power. He knew that you can divide and conquer very easily. Him and his whole team followed the Alinsky strategy, and they divided America. We are now seeing the whirlwind that he sowed. And the question is, how do we calm it down? Well, I did a show the other day called We Can Be Enemies Without Enmity. There is more hatred now from the left than I have seen at any time in my life. I've seen anger before. I've never seen such hatred before. And you have to ask yourself where this hatred is coming from. It certainly has nothing to do with social injustice. It has to do with psychopathology and drugs. Drugs are now more rampant in American society, especially the most evil of all drugs, marijuana, than ever before. And I would wager that most of those wearing the masks and throwing the bricks are stoned out of their minds. They are the assassins of civilization. And we have a Department of Homeland Security that could do something to stop them. They could declare them a terrorist group. They could seek the funding. They could arrest those funding them, and that could be the end of it. Believe me, it ended overnight. Okay, I said my piece. I don't even want to get stuck on it. You know what I'm saying? I'd rather not get stuck on it if I could avoid it. I mean, it's Friday. I'm a human being, you know. Got to relax a little bit, too. So, you know, life goes on. Here's the weekend coming up. Great weekend, almost the end of August already. Some kids are already back in school, right? I see them already, the lunch pails, the backpacks. The poor little kids have to suffer through the brainwashing now for so many years till they get out of that prison of our school system. I enrolled in school last night. Yeah, I did taking courses in art. Would you believe that? Starting next week. I'm not going to say where. I decided to take courses twice a week in painting. I've been painting for many years. I never talk about it. I never show my art. I don't consider it particularly good. Some who have seen it think it's genius. I won't tell you about it. I'm not going to sell you artwork. I'm not selling you a rug with my paintings in them, like a special toupee with my special signature on it. But all I'm saying is I'm taking some classes because I want to get a little better and get a little more control over what I do. You know what I felt like at the minute I enrolled? It's amazing. I felt like a little kid going back to school. I can't wait to go to school again. Here I am with two earned master's degrees, an earned PhD from a great university, and I'm going back to school to take art. Isn't that interesting? Well, I'm doing it for a number of reasons. One, because I feel it'll fill up a lot of the void and obliterate the hatred of the left in America, those who are tearing down my country, and let me just look at color for a few hours a week. I don't want to look at their ugly faces anymore. I want to blot out Nancy Pelosi's deranged voice. I want to blot out the hatred of de Blasio. I want to blot out the hatred of Schumer. I want to blot out the hatred of Woodpecker and Blinky. I don't want to hear them. I don't want to see them. And the best way to do that, of course, is to return either to nature or to art, whatever it is that you have to do. Because you can't just do it with alcohol. You can't do it with drugs. You have to do it with other forms. That's all. Let's take some calls on the Savage Nation, 855-407-282. Death penalty is in the air. Names are in the air. Judges in California are in the air. Pelosi's, what does she have? Is there a neurologist or a psychiatrist in the audience that could tell us what illness Nancy Pelosi has? For her to say that the Constitution does not say that a person can yell wolf in a crowded theater, and she doesn't recognize that it's plain senility. I don't know if you know it, but years ago I was the director of the Alzheimer's Research Institute. You wouldn't know that because I never talk about it. And I've studied neurology. I'm not a neurologist. I'm a PhD bioscientist, let's put it to you that way. If you have a good mind and you know how to study things and how to read literature, you can study anything, to be honest with you. So I would say that she has pre-senile dementia. It would be my diagnosis. And to think that the woman is still in office, I believe that this woman is a clear and present danger both to herself and the nation. KSFO, Bob, welcome to the Savage Nation. What's your topic?
Hey, on the death penalty, Michael, I'm an anesthesiologist, and I was just going to make the comment that one of the big arguments against the death penalty is that the IV injections and so forth are inhumane and such. And it's totally ridiculous, and I'll tell you why. If you're going to have your appendix out, somebody like me is going to give you a certain amount of drugs, and you're going to go to sleep. Now, if somebody was going to execute somebody, you would start out with the pretty much the same cocktail, and you'd go to sleep very pleasantly. On top of that, you could give five times as much as you would give somebody for an appendix.
In other words, it's just dose-dependent anesthesia in plain English, right?
Yeah. Basically, the biggest risk of an overdose of anesthesia is you could kill somebody.
I know. Well, look, I had a colonoscopy about 2 months ago, and they put me on, what was it, propofol? What is it called?
Propofol.
Propofol. I never in my life experienced anything like that. because they just said to me, I mean, the anesthesiologist came in before the procedure and said, what is your name? What is your date of birth? What are you here for? And I woke up, it was over. I never had experienced anything quite like that. And I can see how Michael Jackson got hooked on that stuff. So what you're saying is you can easily OD on that anesthesia, correct?
Yeah, and that would be the goal. And you have to admit, it's very pleasant. I mean, it's the farthest thing from inhumane. I mean, it's a lot of people wake up and it's like, gee, doc, that felt pretty good. What was that? Or whatever. It's like the only difference between...
No, I'm serious. I woke up from it. I didn't even know it had occurred. It was painless. And, of course, no one had told me what to eat or not to eat after the colonoscopy. I immediately went and had a ham and egg sandwich. I shouldn't have done that. But the thing is, a cup of coffee. I was dying for coffee because I couldn't have it for 24 hours. What is the drug that you mentioned? What is the basis of it? What's the molecular structure of that drug?
You know, of propofol?
Yes.
I actually don't know. It's dissolved in a lipid base, a fat base. It's unique to itself. It's not like a barbiturate or a narcotic. It's completely unique. And to be honest, I wouldn't be able to draw out this.
See, now I know you're a real anesthesiologist because you admitted you didn't know something. That's the mark of a real person who admits he doesn't know something. No, I knew you were an anesthesiologist. No, I appreciate that very much. So you're saying for the administration of a lethal dose in a execution, fundamentally it's like anesthesia, but just at a higher dose, correct?
Yes, it is. It's IV anesthesia. It's a higher dose. And you can add, I mean, often they add like potassium to stop the heart, or that you usually wouldn't do, obviously. Or you use a muscle relaxant that requires somebody to be on a ventilator. Obviously, you wouldn't put somebody you're going to execute on a ventilator. But it's the exact same, it's the exact same drugs. It's not just propofol. There's one called midazolam or Versed that's also people really, feel good when they get that for a sedative. And it's,
You know what I don't understand is how people can have a last meal knowing they're going to be executed that night. Why would anyone want to eat the night they're going to be executed? How can they hold any food down? It just shows you how psychopaths behave. They're psychopaths on death row. There's no question about it. All of them are. And what, they want a last meal, whatever it may be? How can they hold food down if they know they're going to die that night?
It's insane.
Thank you. All right, so you're an anesthesiologist, not a neurologist, but with Nancy Pelosi missing words, mixing up words, mangling words, mumbling, would you agree with me that on the surface it looks like she has pre-senile dementia?
She reminds me of, like all of her grandmothers, if she has like three or four grandchildren, it's always like, oh, hey, Bob, I mean Mark, I mean Tom. Or
Okay. So we should take Nancy Pelosi's factual history very, very seriously. You can't yell wolf in a crowded theater. That's fabulous. That was just the best of all of them. All right, Doc, thank you very much for being with us on the Savage Nation. You know what I think I'm going to do for you right here? I think right here and right now, I'm going to tell you about Optima Tax. You know why? Because it's a very important subject. Because if you owe back taxes to the IRS, you're really not going to like hearing about their 92% conviction rate. You know what that means? It means the evil IRS wins 92% of tax avoided cases, which they choose to prosecute. Okay, maybe you've skated by this long, but they're coming for you. They're coming, and you have to get out in front of your IRS problems before they show up at your home and work, before they take your paycheck and bank accounts, and before they add you to their 92% conviction rate. I want you to call Optima Tax Relief because they're the experts. They step between you and the IRS and start resolving the problems that keep you up at night. How? Well, you call them. Ask them how they've resolved over $500 million of tax debt for their clients. Ask them about their A-plus rating with the Better Business Bureau. Ask about the Fresh Start program with a chance to settle your back taxes for pennies on a dollar. They are amazing. I know it because I see the success stories. They're real, and they do the job. Call 800-731-2474. 800-731-2474. Once again, 800-731-2474. This is the Savage Nation back in a minute.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282. Savage.
The Savage Nation is sponsored by Swiss America, the only company I trust with my financial future. Call 800-289-2646 or swissamerica.com. Greta. from the world of Islamofascism in Europe. This just happened about 30 minutes ago. Man, no identification, man, shot and killed after attack on soldiers in central Brussels. They don't describe the man, but it's a man with a machete. I guess it wasn't a rabbi, it wasn't a priest, it wasn't a Buddhist monk, it wasn't a Hindu man, but it's just a man. A man with a knife was shot and killed after attacking soldiers in central Brussels. The unidentified suspect made the attack in the city shopping district on Friday evening, according to broadcaster VRT. Police had not speculated on a motive. Oh, no, I didn't scream Allahu Akbar. I guess that wouldn't be motive enough. And there's no connection to any religion or any creed. Un homme armé d'un machete a attaqué des soldats à des bruxelles centre. Le soldat en ouvert le feu. His alleged assault comes as the latest outburst of violence in the Belgian capital, where an attack, yeah, right, by the Islamic, oh, they worked in Islamic State, killed 32 people. So this is a developing story. Europe will soon be gone. Unless the right wing takes over every European nation, there's no Europe anymore. It's gone. It's finished. It's over. The invasion will be complete in your lifetime. You think I'm making it up? Attention, all you liberals in New York. This place is lost. Barcelona chief rabbi tells Spain's Jews to leave and head for Israel. I guess he should be considered an anti-Semite now because he's not compliant with the European Union. The chief rabbi of Barcelona, Spain, told Spain's Jews to head for Israel. Are you listening to me? He's doing it because the Islamists are out of control. Spain is Europe's hub for Islamist terror, and the time has come for Jews to head for Israel and safety, Barcelona's chief rabbi has warned. I guess this will be offensive to all the liberal practitioners here in America. Rabbi Meir Bar-Hen delivered the grim personal message on Friday of last week in the aftermath of the terror attack in Barcelona that claimed 14 and left over 100 injured. He told his congregants, don't think we're here for good, and I encourage them to buy property in Israel. He said, this place is lost. Don't repeat the mistake of Algerian Jews, of Venezuelan Jews. Better get out early than late. Europe is lost. Can you believe what I'm telling you? Listen to what he just said to you. Don't repeat the mistake of Algerian Jews or Venezuelan Jews. Now, I got to spend a minute on this Algerian thing. Most of you leftists don't have but one side of every story. And you constantly say Israel stole Arab land. But you never talk about what was done to the Jewish people who had been living prior to the founding of the State of Israel in the late 40s. The Jews who have been there for hundreds of years living in the crescent, northern crescent of Africa, Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia. Just look on a map. Jewish communities had been there for hundreds and hundreds of years. They were well established in the community, living at peace with their Arab neighbors. Well, guess what happened? When Israel was founded, radical Islamists stole all the property of the Jews in those countries and kicked the Jews out, who had to flee, guess where? To Israel. So that's the other side of that story. The Jews are leaving mainland Europe, because of the Muslim terrorism. Make no mistake about it. And now let's look at what Jewish activists are doing here in New York City, because this one got my goat yesterday in the New York Post. Jewish activists target removal of Peter Stuyvesant Monument. You're not going to believe this. You're not going to believe what I'm about to read to you. Some girl from the Sherat HaDin Israel Law Center. Whenever you hear the word law center, just put the word Marxist Law Center in front of it. Some girl said, you got to get rid of Peter Stuyvesant. Get rid of Stuyvesant High School because he's a symbol of hate. This communist leftist girl said Peter Stuyvesant was an extreme racist who targeted Jews and other minorities, including Catholics, and tried to prohibit them from settling in then New Amsterdam, said Nitzana Darshan Leitner, the head of the Sherat HaDin Israel Law Center. She wants it gone. She wants Stuyvesant's name taken down. Well, a spokesman for the New Netherlands Institute disagrees with her. They research America's Dutch history, and they call the idea ridiculous. This is an entirely different case. This was about customs in the 17th century, said the spokesman, arguing that the name Stuyvesant and Stuyvesant himself opposed any religion outside of his own church to maintain social cohesion and due to ignorant ideas about disease. But you see, to a Marxist, there is no history. to a Marxist there is only today. And while you're at it, why don't you ask yourself why this brave woman, Nitzana Darshan Leitner, has not said a word about radical Islam?
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE. Savage. Warning, the Savage Nation contains adult language, adult content, psychological nudity. Listener discretion is advised. And now, America's most exciting radio talk show, the Savage Nation, home of borders, language, culture. And here he is, winner of the National Radio Hall of Fame Award, Michael Savage.
We plan heavily. We get sound. We get stories. Then I sometimes go off the message. I talk about other stuff. And right now, I don't know what. It's not like I ate and I feel like I'm tired now. I didn't eat at all. Normally, my energy is high and then it goes low. Today, it's like flat. It's like flat today. Why is it flat? We're waiting for the storm now to hit Texas. What if a storm doesn't hit Texas? What if it like veers off? Like, whoop, it almost, it happens every year. Like, storm threatens Gulf Coast. Cat 3, Cat 9, Cat 5, major disaster. Well, let's hope at the last minute it goes like, up. But what if it does hit 120-mile-an-hour winds? What if they get 35 inches of rain? And what if Trump's disaster relief people don't do their job? Can you imagine the screams? I guarantee you they're already lining up with busloads of protesters saying that he could have stopped the storm if only he wanted to stop it, but it hit a largely minority area, that God himself is a racist because he aimed the storm at a minority area in Houston. You can see all the garbage that's going to happen already. No matter what happens, no matter what Trump does, he caused the storm. They're probably busting themselves in already. Well, we have an eye. I have a great affiliate in, thank God, KLIF and up there in Dallas. You're not going to get hit, are you, Jim? Jim, no? Not supposed to hit you up there? Thank God you're safe up there. Not supposed. I'm not going to go that high up there in Texas. You live near the water. Every so often, storms come in off the ocean. They come in off the water. It's a fact of life. It's how nature works. It usually happens around this time of year. If you look historically, there are indications that there have been other storms in this exact region of Texas. Now it is called Harvey. But there was other periods. In the 60s, a big one hit. And a lot of people died. Let's hope it doesn't happen again. I mean, but the thing is, you know, if you're there, get out of there. Just leave. There's going to be people moving and this and storms and whatever. Flooding, winds, tornadoes, power outages. 10 to 20 inches of rain over a large part of southern and eastern Texas. And what are you going to do about it? What can you do about it? Blame Trump. Pelosi already has the speech written. Sharpton already has the airplane loaded. He's ready. That because Trump didn't do the right thing, the storm was worse. If he had only acted properly and built the levees, it wouldn't have flooded a large... What are you, crazy people out there? Everything doesn't have to be political. There are natural causes of things that have nothing to do with politics. But you can't tell that to fools. You know, dealing with fools is dealing with fools. So what am I going to talk about, a storm? Let's talk about the storm. Life-threatening rainfall expected in Texas, says Hurricane Center on the Extreme Weather Channel. Well, I hope they're wrong. But by the way, highways in Texas are filled with cars into the night. Last night already, as coastal residents made their way north and out of the path of the hurricane. And it's not a laughing matter, okay, because it's building up its punch. And it could hit in Corpus Christi. It could be a Cat 3, winds of 111 miles an hour. By the time it hits the middle of the Texas coast, late Friday or early Saturday. And you know they're going to politicize it. What should Trump do about it? You know, that's a good question. Let me ask you, what should Trump do now about the storm to show he really is in charge? What should he do, go there now and do what, yell at the storm, scream MAGA at it? You know, there was a time in history when in Sweden, I believe it is, the ice, we're talking about the little ice age in the Middle Ages. Many of you liberals don't know there was a little ice age. You didn't get that at Harvard. But in the little ice age, ice was actually aggressing onto regions of Europe and other places, and it was coming down into the valleys of Sweden, the ice. It was increasing because the Earth had gone into a little ice age rather than a warming phase. It went into a cooling phase as we are in now. And there are reports that priests held up crosses and walked to the edges of the glaciers and tried to do an incantation against the glacier to keep it from moving further into the civilized areas. Would you believe that? Well, maybe Trump can go there now and stand there and try to fend off the storm. Maybe that would make the liberal Bolsheviks happy. Leave the guy alone already. Who can manage this country? Do you actually think there's anyone on earth who can manage the United States of America being as broken as it is? You know, that's a bigger question than any. I haven't actually thought about that. Patrick Buchanan wrote a fabulous article. He's such a brilliant guy. He wrote What Still Unites Us. It's a fabulous article. It's on patbuchanan.com. And I don't want to quote the whole thing, but he is really right on when he writes this thing. He says, against what the neocons, traditionalists, argued, that while America was uniquely great, the nation was united by faith, culture, language, history, heroes, holidays, mores, manners, customs, and traditions. A common feature of Americans, black and white, was pride in belonging to a people that had achieved so much. And then he says, the insight attributed to Alexis de Tocqueville, that America is great because she is good, and if America ceases to be good, she will cease to be great, was a belief shared by almost all. And then Pat writes that what makes our future appear problematic is that what once united us now divides us. While Presidents Wilson and Truman declared us to be a Christian nation, Christianity has been purged from our public life and sheds believers every decade. Atheism and agnosticism are growing rapidly, especially among the young. Traditional morality grounded in Christianity is being discarded. Half of all marriages end in divorce. 4 in 10 children are born out of wedlock. Unrestricted abortion and same-sex marriage, once regarded as marks of decadence and decline, are now seen as human rights and the hallmarks of social progress. Tens of millions of us do not speak English. Where most of our music used to be classic, popular, country and western and jazz, much of it now contains rutting lyrics that used to be unprintable. I like that, rutting lyrics. Where we used to have 3 national networks, we have 3 24-hour cable news channels and 1,000 websites that reinforce our clashing beliefs on morality, culture, politics, and race. That's very interesting stuff. Consider what's happened since Charlottesville. The word murderer was painted on the San Fernando statue of Father Junipero Serra, the Franciscan who founded the missions that became San Diego, San Francisco, San Juan Capistrano, and Santa Clara. America's oldest monument honoring Columbus in Baltimore was vandalized. Senator Tim Kaine of Virginia called for Robert E. Lee's statue to be removed from Capitol and replaced by Pocahontas. No, I don't want to read any more of this insanity. So I'm asking you a question related to this. Hillary Clinton, as you know, described you and I, this segment of America that listens to this program and others like it, as deplorables, who are racist, sexist, homophobic, xenophobic, Islamophobic, and bigots. She said we are irredeemable. That's what she did. So who can rule this country and bring us together? Do you think there is anyone on the American political landscape, anyone at all, who can bring us together, unite us? I've never asked that question, Jim. I see even my call screen has stopped screening to look up at me like I may be onto something. No, it's a great question. Okay, you're going to blame Trump now for the storm about to hit Texas. Harvey now, they're going to blame him on Harvey. The liberals will call it Hurricane Donald. And I'm asking you a much more important question. You know Hillary couldn't have done anything for this country but divide. You know, have you thought about where we'd be 9 months into a Hillary regime? Have you thought about the assaults on the First Amendment, the Second Amendment, the Third Amendment, the Fourth Amendment? Have you thought about how your children in this country would be running in fear for being white, as the hatred would have amped up under Hillary? This hatred of white people would have amped up, not amped down. So I don't know that Trump is as bad as the left says, by the way. I'm not going to say he's a great man, because it's never been about him for me. Have I ever told you that? Well, let me stand up and tell you that. It was never about Donald Trump for me. I didn't know the man. It was about his ideas, which were mine. His ideas that he discussed, he mirrored during the campaign were almost identical to mine on borders, language, and culture. After all, who wrote as many books as I did, spelling out as completely and as carefully as I did the entire strategy of Donald Trump? Nobody. He even said, without this man, I wouldn't be president. He said it in front of the entire crowd of people at Mar-a-Lago, and I thank him for it. I'm sure he meant it when he said it, because I didn't hear him say it about anyone else. I was very proud of that moment. And when I went up to him and I told him I was a certain age, you know what he said? He said, you need another 25 years. The country needs you. Well, that was beautiful. So it was never about the man. It was about the ideas that he ran down the field with. I want to know what other person on the stage, man or woman, could unite this nation. Can you give me an example of someone who could bring this country together? Bernie Sanders is going to bring it together, that demagogue, the seltzer man. Hillary Clinton's finished. She's never going to win again. All they're doing on the Democrat side is seeing who can go further to the left. Left, 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 left. And they're going to be left out of the political discussion because they're losing the entire center of this country. So let me ask you again, who can bring this country together? So before you say Trump is that evil, because now there's a mass hysteria on this issue. It's a hysteria that I've never seen in my lifetime, with a piling on along the lines of pulling down the statues. Who could unite this country and bring it together? The morons who say they're going to run. I love it. Every moronic sports figure now, kid this and Schmendrick that, he's going to run. He's going to be president now. Every putz is going to run for them. Actors are going to run. Actors are going to run. Sports figures, they're not going to win. What they don't understand is they're so stupid, these people. They're figuring, oh, if Donald Trump could win, why anyone could win? Well, they're wrong. They don't understand something, which is the fundamental of Trump's victory. Trump didn't win because he's Trump. Trump won because he had ideas that resonated with enough people. So you get a moron actor on the left, he's going to run because he's a famous actor. But he has no ideas to run with. What are his ideas? I'm beautiful. He's not going to win. The left's not going to support him. The middle's not going to support him. Nothing. It's a self-aggrandizement. Only someone with the right ideas can win. I'll be right back. Tell me who it is.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282. Savage.
The Savage Nation is sponsored by Swiss America, the only company I trust with my financial future. Call 800-289-2646 or SwissAmerica.com. On the Savage Nation, welcome back.
Will you be mine?
Makes me feel good. That's why I'm playing it. Maybe to offend somebody.
Love you all the time.
Marketing back to an America where my mother could walk to the corner for a loaf of bread without being molested by a bum. I'm harkening back to an America where a cop, if you looked him the wrong way, will take you in the back room and give you a shellacking with a nightstick, and the streets were safer. I can go down the list, but I respect the job I have, so I'll stop right there, because if I tell you the vision I have for America, you may not be too happy. But I'm asking you a question. Who can bring this country together again? It's easy to say, oh, Trump is this, Trump is that, Trump is evil, he caused the storm, he caused the this, he caused the rain not to fall, he caused the rain to fall, he caused an accident, he caused cancer, he caused heart attacks. Stop being so stupid. Who can bring this country together again when you have an idiot like Pelosi saying he's encouraged Nazis and white supremacists? Nothing can be further from the truth. It's women like Pelosi who are encouraging Nazis and white supremacists to riot because they can't take it anymore. What do you think, this comes out of a vacuum? Who can bring this country together is what I'm asking you. Ron on WABC, do you have an answer to that question?
Yeah, Dr. Savage, no one can. As long as you have people like George Soros funding these organizations to rip us apart, I don't see how it could happen.
How does he get away with it? Why does Donald Trump not go after George Soros under RICO laws?
He should go after him. He should go after him, the Black Lives Matter, and everybody. I thought that...
Black Lives Matter got a donation of $85 million last year from the George Soros front groups. That was the beginning of their first donation from the Soros machine. Why doesn't this country come to understand that agitators like George Soros are the reason for the problems we're having? That if you cut the funding off from these radical groups, you'll cut off the radicalism. 90% of these street groups are not spontaneous. Most of them are funded and planned from central planning. And it takes a lot of money, and it takes a lot of organization. And they have to be approached the way organized crime was approached, the way terrorism is approached. And we have a Department of Homeland Security, but I'm asking you another question. Trump knows this. Why doesn't he go after George Soros?
That's a good question.
Well, I'm going to give you... There's an answer to that question as well. And it's not a pretty answer. About a month ago, there was a party in New York or Washington at which we saw several of Trump's inner circle socializing with none other than George Soros. Hobnobbing, having cocktails. What does that tell you?
That tells me it's a big scam.
It tells you that at the top of the pyramid, they're all the same. It tells you at the top of the mirror, they may want this agitation. It tells you that they want Antifa to riot. They want Black Lives Matter to riot, that they're actually puppets of the power structure to both intimidate the middle class and to make them afraid and need the government even more. That is a theory that is operational to me. I'm sorry to tell you. And if it's a conspiracy theory, so could call me what you want. So, you know, I hearkened back in the last hour, and I said, what happened to my country? It was so beautiful in the 50s. So someone sends me an email and says, there were actually hate crimes against blacks occurring and being covered up or excused in the 50s. Were there not? And I said, yes, there most certainly were, but they did not define America. This is the whole point that you're missing. Of course there were terrible things done in the 50s. But those terrible things did not define the nation. The left is trying to say they defined the nation. Just they're trying to tell you that Robert E. Lee defined hatred and Nazism when it didn't. They have everything wrong. No, it didn't define the nation. Not at all. There were great things done in the 50s as well. Really, really great things. You want me to name them? Shall I name all the great things that were done in America in the 50s? All the great inventions? All the great advancements? Or must you focus only on the hate? Because if you focus only on the hate, then you're the hater.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282. Savage.
Welcome back to the Savage Nation. Anywhere out of this world.
My lover stands on
the stench of the bench is making me clench. This great nation of ours is being torn apart by the vermin on the left. They want us to be ashamed. They want us to be sick of our own nation. They want those of us who are not of color to hate ourselves. The left has a rage that I've never seen in my life. Where it is coming from is, well, you could put two and two together. It's being taught in the schools. It's being funded by very, very evil people. There's also a huge, huge relationship to the prevalence of marijuana, which brings out violence in people, and they don't even know it. You don't know it, I don't know it. But the very same man, George Soros, who was funding many of these left-wing groups, was the first one to introduce the idea that there should be a thing called medical marijuana legalized. I remember fighting it in 1998. He spent $1 million in Arizona and California to push legalized marijuana. And I said, well, if it works against pain and diseases, well, then keep it as a drug. Isolate the compounds in the cannabis plant that are therapeutic and use them as medicines. But it was never about medicine. Never. I saw from the get-go what Soros wanted. He wanted to drug an entire generation in order to manipulate them, make them more murderous, in my estimation, make them more like the assassins whose name itself, assassins, comes from the drug that was used and may still be used by Arab assassins, hashish. Yes, the word hashish, hassassin, the same root word in Arabic. People become extremely violent on the cannabis. They may not know it. That's what makes them even more dangerous. But in tearing down our nation, they are assassinating our nation. And so, just to continue with Pat Buchanan's article, What Still Unites Us, he says, to another slice of America, much of the celebrated social and moral progress of recent decades induces a sense of nausea. Hillary Clinton famously described us, this segment of America, as a basket of deplorables, that we are racist, sexist, homophobic, xenophobic, Islamophobic bigots, and we're irredeemable. Now, I got to pause at that for a reason. In the Soviet Union during the 1930s, prior to the execution of millions of people and the enslavement of millions of Russians by fellow Russians, they were first defamed like this. The farmers who were providing the wheat and the food for all of Russia were minor capitalists at the time. They raised the crops through great, great labor and great risk, and they sold the crops and made a small profit. Stalin came along and started a smear campaign, a propaganda campaign, calling them kulaks, which was an offensive term, maybe along the lines of cracker, or worse yet. He called all farmers kulaks, and that started the campaign against them. And eventually the farmers were taken off their own land. The land was seized by the government. And the so-called kulaks were enslaved in slave labor camps or executed outright. You're witnessing a stage of a revolution in this country along the lines of the revolution against the landowners of Russia, the farmers, or against the landowners that we saw killed and mutilated in South Africa, worse yet in Rhodesia, Zimbabwe. You know any about that? Anything about that? Because that's what's going on in this country. If this is not stopped, you're going to see what happened in South Africa or in Rhodesia in this country, as sure as I'm sitting here. And so I ask you again, when you have haters like Hillary Clinton and Mario de Blasio stirring up hatred for the middle class, which is what they are doing, who can unite this nation? What can hold us together? What can still make us a nation? I don't know the answer. What can bring us together? Who can bring us together? I don't know. I don't have the answer. There are many answers. First of all, there are laws in this country. And the second reason I'm somewhat optimistic is this. The reason they had a revolution in Russia is because there was massive hunger and starvation. Fortunately, there's fatness and obesity in America. And so there's a very low likelihood that the masses will ever rise up. They're fat and happy. They got food stamps. They got welfare. They got drugs, both legal and illegal. It's going to keep them down on the farm. So unless there's massive starvation in America, there will never be a Marxist revolution. Never. I'll tell you that right now. Secondly, we have the most professional police forces in the world. The most, bar none, in the entire world are in this country. And they're armed to the gills, thank God. Unlike other nations that have been deballed, like Finland, Sweden, France, we are armed to the gills and the cops are highly trained and highly accurate in the use of lethal force, thank God. And so for those reasons, we're not going to have a Marxist revolution. Now, to top it all off, we have a president who understands all of this. He does not want a revolution. He does not want it to happen, and he knows what's going on, as do the generals. They know what's going on. They know who's behind it. And now that push has come to shove, if these leftists continue to push and shove, I know what's coming. You don't have to be a genius to see what's coming. Remember the Kent State massacre? That's what's coming. And of course, they may want that. They may want it to say, see, we told you they're fascists. See, they killed these innocent people. They called out the National Guard and they killed this poor innocent girl who was just simply there exercising her First Amendment rights. Maybe they want it. Maybe that's why they're egging these college kids on. It's anyone's guess what anyone really wants. I know what I want. I want law and order. I want peace and stability. I want my nation back. It's that simple. Who can bring us together? I don't know who can. Do you have any ideas? Sean, line nine. Who can bring this nation together?
In retrospect, nobody, not one individual at this moment in time can bring the nation together. There is too big of a gap in what they teach in schools, and I would say, let's go with how you grew up, the real world. You go out and it's the people. You have to go talk. You have to get a movement. You just have to not let them, I guess I would say.
Well, I try to counter the insanity of the left on this program every day, and I have for 22 years. And my theme is borders, language, and culture. I don't care what your race is. I don't care what your religion is. I don't care where you come from. Those are the defining elements of a nation, including the nations they left behind. Can anyone listening to this show not understand that China, for example, is defined by its borders, language, and culture very clearly? So they're very clearly defined by their borders of China, by their languages, and by their culture, their common culture, the culture of China, which is very ancient. And they're all proud of it. Name a nation on earth that is not proud of its borders, language, and culture. Mexicans, for example. They're very proud of their borders. In fact, when Guatemalans try to get into Mexico to come to America, they have a terrible, terrible time of it. I have met people from El Salvador, hardworking people, by the way, from Guatemala, and they have told me horror stories that you can't believe. What was done to them by the Mexicans, you'll never believe, because it never makes it to the local communist press here in America. They are beaten. They are tortured. If they're women, they are raped. They're robbed of everything they have, and then they're thrown over the American border. That's if they get out of there alive. That's the wonderful, sacred nation of Mexico. The Mexicans love their nation. They have a very proud identity as Mexicans. Look at the flags they wave at fights and sporting events. They know what their nation is. They define themselves by their borders, language, and culture. Why can't we? Why shouldn't we? Well, we must. We must define ourselves all over again by our national identity, our borders, language, and culture. And that is what I'm really struggling for every day. That's what I am totally struggling for. Borders, language, and culture. And there's nothing more I have to say about it. You can read any one of the many books I've written. You can listen to this broadcast every day to know that the message I am delivering on this program every day is one of unity, one of bringing people together, not division. The dividers are clearly so. They're clearly self-identified as such. And so I will leave it at that. I want to go back to the emailer who said to me when I said, where did my country go? Who stole it from me? Who said, well, there were hate crimes against blacks occurring and being covered up in the 50s, weren't there? And I said, yes, but they did not define the nation. And the emailer said, right, and now they're not happening anymore. And yet they still define the nation according to the left. Do you understand what they're doing? They're taking a black eye on America and they're making it the whole eye. Can't let that happen. Cannot let that happen. It's the same with the Robert E. Lee statues. I have told you, of all the figures to pick on, he was the least racist of them all. Robert E. Lee was such a great military man that President Lincoln himself asked him to head the Union Army. Most of the adults on the left don't know that because they're uneducated. They went to NYU or Columbia, where all they learn is hatred, by and large, in the social sciences. Maybe there's still some science being taught somewhere. God only knows if that's permitted anymore, without injecting the garbage of racism and everything. But nevertheless, so Robert E. Lee was such a great war hero, let's say a great military man, that President Lincoln said, can you please lead the Union Army? And Robert E. Lee, according to the historians who have studied this, spent the night thinking about that. He came back and he said, I cannot do that, President Lincoln, because I am loyal to my state first, not to this nation. And so he became the leader of the Confederate Army. He didn't become a leader because he believed in slavery. He became a leader because he believed in his mission as a military man. So of all the people's statues to pull down, he is the worst that you can pick on. But the communists who are doing this and the mad dogs, you ever see the faces of the mad dogs who are pulling the statues down? Isn't it odd that they're mostly obese, disgusting women? Have you seen that it's mainly obese, militant women who are doing this? People who hate themselves and hate everything around them, they're filled with hatred. Now there are laws on the land against this. I would increase the penalties for defacing any statues or memorials in the United States of America. I would increase the penalties, not decrease them. And I put them in jail and make them do hard time if this goes on. Because if it is not stopped, it's never going to stop. It's going to come right to your neighborhood. It'll come right to your house. And they'll take your property away from you. I'm warning you what's going to happen unless we get tough on them. We need law and order, and we need it right now. And Trump can do it. He's the one to do it. He's hated anyway by the left. What has he got to lose if he does it? What has he got to lose if he cracks down on these people even harder? Now, I also talked about the death penalty. It's a very important topic. The California Supreme Court is extremely dangerous in what they just did. They acted like Marxist dictators, not like fair and balanced judges. Let us take some callers on that topic. One quick one. Daniel on KSFO Line 4. What's your story on the death penalty?
Hey, Dr. Savage, thanks for taking the call. You know, I was one time, many years ago, I was facing the death penalty for, you know, I was running around with my hair on fire and I did what I did. But I spent many years in prison fighting, you know, basically whatever, sentences of all kinds and whatever, and really watching the California Supreme Court. And I've seen the California Supreme Court change its own opinion. There was one, there were two cases several years ago, one case called Dannenberg, and then...
Well, as a former inmate in the state of California, do you agree or disagree that the death penalty needs to be maintained, number one, and that executions need to be speeded up to within 5 years of conviction? Because that's what the ballot initiative said, that these judges just overruled. Do you think that people who are convicted should be executed within 5 years after their appeals, after all of their appeals are gone through?
Look, people are spending entire careers, I mean, 20, 25 years of their lives on these death rows, fighting stuff, fighting something that ultimately, the vast majority of the time, results in their death anyways. They get that state-issue flu shot.
Well, that is because the lawyers make a life career out of this. Never forget that there's a huge industry around fighting the death penalty. Check out the lawyers whose whole life is spent, not because they care about justice necessarily, but because they care about their own career fighting death penalties. Look, if you committed a crime and you're innocent, of course you should be released. But if you commit a crime and you've had two appeals, 5 years is plenty of time, and that is why that ballot initiative passed. And Governor Brown, if he wants to show any fairness, should step in and override the Supreme Court if he has that power. I'll be right back.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282. Savage.
The Savage Nation is sponsored by Swiss America, the only company I trust with my financial future. Call 800-289-2646 or SwissAmerica.com. Dr. Michael Savage back with you. You've heard me talk about blood flow, right? You know I've talked about super beets. It's one of the most impressive natural functional foods I've ever seen. That's why I'm talking about it. Look, we all know that healthy circulation is critical, especially as we get older, but there's a natural way to support healthy blood flow, and that is by getting enough dietary nitrates into your body to convert into nitric oxide. Super beets is the easiest way to get this done. A single scoop in water or a smoothie, you're all set. It's the secret to helping support healthy circulation and healthy blood pressure levels. Super Beets works three times faster to give you results you can feel. You'll feel the energy and stamina within 20 minutes of taking it, or you're going to get your money back. And if you haven't tried it yet, now is the time. For a limited time, you'll get 10 on-the-go packets of Super Beets to pop in your desk drawer, purse, or gym bag. You'll get more energy, more stamina, and you'll support healthy circulation. What are you waiting for? This is on top of the free canister, free indicator strips, and a free book plus free shipping with your first order. All you got to do is call 800-481-0504. Write it down, 800-481-0504. Or go to SavageLovesBeats.com. That's SavageLovesBeats.com. It is guaranteed you get your money back. Call 800-481-0504. That's 800-481-0504. Or go to SavageLovesBeats.com. You got it? Well, get it. That's SavageLovesBeats.com. And now we have breaking news on the Savage Nation. It's not very good news, but it's tied in again to Islamofascism, although that's not being reported. Buckingham Palace is on lockdown. after a man. They can't say Muslim or Islamic terrorist. A man armed with a sword. I guess the man armed with the sword was a priest that went mad, or a rabbi. Not. He attacked two police officers right in front of Buckingham Palace, right in front of tourists. But the vermin in the media in England will not define who the man is. They said a man has been arrested in connection with the attack. In Belgium, a man has been attacked after attacking cops with a sword. When the hell are you going to wake up to the fact that your countries have been invaded? The Islamo-fascists are here. And I'm not going to say man. It may offend you if you're a leftist, but you know where you can go? You can go there on a one-way ticket and a handbasket. I am not giving up my nation, and I don't want the millions of my followers to give up either. It's not a man. It's an Islamo-fascist man.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE. Savage. Warning. The Savage Nation contains adult language, adult content, psychological nudity. Listener discretion is advised. And now, America's most exciting radio talk show, The Savage Nation, home of borders, language, culture. And here he is, winner of the National Radio Hall of Fame Award, Michael Savage.
Some more news from the world of Islamo-fascism in Europe. Man, no identification, man, shot and killed after attack on soldiers in central Brussels. They don't describe the man, but it's a man with a machete. I guess it wasn't a rabbi, it wasn't a priest, it wasn't a Buddhist monk, it wasn't a Hindu man, but it's just a man. A man with a knife was shot and killed after attacking soldiers in central Brussels. The unidentified suspect made the attack in the city shopping district on Friday evening, according to broadcaster VRT. Police had not speculated on a motive. Oh, no, I didn't scream Allahu Akbar. I guess that wouldn't be motive enough. And there's no connection to any religion or any creed. Un homme armé d'un machete a attaqué des soldats à des brûchères centrales. Les soldats ont ouvert le feu. His alleged assault comes as the latest outburst of violence in the Belgian capital, where an attack, yeah, right, by the Islamic, oh, they worked in Islamic State, killed 32 people. So this is a developing story. Europe will soon be gone. Unless the right wing takes over every European nation, there's no Europe anymore. It's gone. It's finished. It's over. The invasion will be complete in your lifetime. You think I'm making it up? Attention, all you liberals in New York. This place is lost. Barcelona chief rabbi tells Spain's Jews to leave and head for Israel. I guess he should be considered an anti-Semite now because he's not compliant with the European Union. The chief rabbi of Barcelona, Spain, told Spain's Jews to head for Israel. Are you listening to me? He's doing it because the Islamists are out of control. Spain is Europe's hub for Islamist terror, and the time has come for Jews to head for Israel and safety, Barcelona's chief rabbi has warned. I guess this will be offensive to all the liberal practitioners here in America. Rabbi Meir Bar-Hen delivered the grim personal message on Friday of last week in the aftermath of the terror attack in Barcelona that claimed 14 and left over 100 injured. He told his congregants, "Don't think we're here for good, and I encourage them to buy property in Israel." He said, "This place is lost. Don't repeat the mistake of Algerian Jews, of Venezuelan Jews. Better get out early than late. Europe is lost." Can you believe what I'm telling you? Listen to what he just said to you. Don't repeat the mistake of Algerian Jews or Venezuelan Jews. Now, I got to spend a minute on this Algerian thing. Most of you leftists don't have but one side of every story. And you constantly say Israel stole Arab land. But you never talk about what was done to the Jewish people who had been living prior to the founding of the State of Israel in the late 40s. The Jews who have been there for hundreds of years living in the crescent, northern crescent of Africa, Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia. Just look on a map. Jewish communities had been there for hundreds and hundreds of years. They were well established in the community, living at peace with their Arab neighbors. Well, guess what happened? When Israel was founded, radical Islamists stole all the property of the Jews in those countries and kicked the Jews out, who had to flee, guess where? To Israel. So that's the other side of that story. The Jews are leaving mainland Europe, because of the Muslim terrorism. Make no mistake about it. And now let's look at what Jewish activists are doing here in New York City. Because this one got my goat yesterday in the New York Post. Jewish activists target removal of Peter Stuyvesant Monument. You're not going to believe this. You're not going to believe what I'm about to read to you. Some girl from the Sherat HaDin Israel Law Center. Whenever you hear the word law center, just put the word Marxist Law Center in front of it. Some girl said, you got to get rid of Peter Stuyvesant. Get rid of Stuyvesant High School because he's a symbol of hate. This communist leftist girl said Peter Stuyvesant was an extreme racist who targeted Jews and other minorities, including Catholics, and tried to prohibit them from settling in then New Amsterdam, said Nitzana Darshan Leitner, the head of the Sherat HaDin Israel Law Center. She wants it gone. She wants Stuyvesant's name taken down. Well, a spokesman for the New Netherlands Institute disagrees with her. They research America's Dutch history, and they call the idea ridiculous. This is an entirely different case. This was about customs in the 17th century, said the spokesman, arguing that the name Stuyvesant and Stuyvesant himself opposed any religion outside of his own church to maintain social cohesion and due to ignorant ideas about disease. But you see, to a Marxist, there is no history. To a Marxist, there is only today. And while you're at it, why don't you ask yourself why this brave woman, Nitzana Darshan Leitner, has not said a word about radical Islam? Here's a little side note. Here in California, we have a thing called a ballot initiative, you know, where they make believe that we have the power to decide things, the vermin who run the state, the filth in black robes. Well, we voted. We did it legally. No one ran anyone over. No one pulled out a gun. No one pepper sprayed. Like good little sheeple, we went to the ballot, to the voting box, and we voted and we said we want the death penalty speeded up. If you've been tried and convicted numerous times, we want you fried within or gassed or injected within 5 years. Because the average tenure on death row in this sick state of ours is 20 years. Now, there are lawyers who made a fortune off death penalty cases. You got to understand, there's a lot of money involved in the appeal of death penalty cases. They don't all do it because they have any sympathy for them at all. This is a full-time job for many of these left-wing loser lawyers who can't get a job at a regular firm. All right, so we voted, and it says that the state of California shall make sure that those convicted of, you know, crimes and found guilty and gone through appeals shall be executed within 5 years. So a few stinking judges on the California Supreme Court, left-wing goombas, really bad ones, really bad, bad. You know what the word elitist means? Filth like this. These filthy, dirty bums on the California Supreme Court, there's no other word to describe them. They're the lowest of the grubyon lawyer who politicized and got themselves a stinking job in the Supreme Court. You know what they said? They said the word shall is not a directive, it's a suggestion. We shall decide what it actually means. Now, how many years have I told you the stench from the bench is making me clench? What the hell is the good of voting if a few rotten, stinking leftist judges can override the votes of millions? They did this to us before. Prop 209 we passed. There shall be no racial considerations in hiring in state positions. I worked very hard for that 20 years ago. One rotten, stinking judge who came over from the ACLU, Thelton Henderson. I remember his name to this day. May he rot in you nowhere. Thelton Henderson, one rotten, stinking left-wing judge, with the stroke of a pen, nullify the votes of 6 million people. We passed Prop 66, said the court shall resolve capital appeals in 5 years, more than twice as fast as its current pace. But the majority of rotten, stinking judges on the California Supreme Court just ruled 5-2 to reinterpret the language as a directive or a recommendation to work faster, not to do what it says. They said a mandatory deadline would undermine the court's authority as a separate branch of government. You are wrong. You work for the people, you rotten, stinking, elitist judges. Time to go. That was written by Justice so-called Carol Corrigan in a majority opinion. Can you believe this? Can you believe what judges are doing in this country? But are you surprised? Don't you know what lawyers are like? Don't you know what lawyers are in general, except my lawyers? Don't you know who they are? And what is a judge? A judge is an aggressive, greedy lawyer who used politics to become a judge. And the more corrupt they are, the higher they go. By and large, that's how it works. So there it is. We vote, and what we get is nothing. They go around it. They make the law what it isn't. They rewrite the law in their own mentality. Now, 20 years ago, I warned on this radio program when I was only a local talk show, so I shouldn't say local because it was a very important position for me. I shook up San Francisco and the country, for that matter, with my fiery broadcasts. People had never heard anything like it. That was back in 94, 95. I warned the liberal judges, and what's happening is it's coming true, unfortunately, with all these riots and rallies, the Nazis, the KKK. I warned them what would happen. I said, if you deny us our vote at the ballot box, you're liable to face the bullet box, the ammo box. That's just how I put it. I'm quoting myself. You keep denying people their due process. You keep stealing their birthright. You keep telling them to drop dead because they're of a certain race. I'm warning you, you're going to have hellfire in this nation. There's only so much BS that people will take. And we're past that point in American history. These rotten, stinking judges must understand they're not God Almighty. They're just stinking lawyers in a black robe. And their robes need a good cleaning. They need to be modernized, sanitized, homogenized, pasteurized. So we voted. Passed by a wide margin, by the way. Voter-approved initiative. Throughout the state now, you see, because it wasn't just in San Francisco. It was statewide. Voter-approved initiative speeding up executions in California. So these rotten, stinking Supreme Court justices go around and they say, well, Prop 66 said the court shall resolve capital appeals in 5 years. They said, well, the word shall doesn't mean anything. We'll decide what shall mean. I have no other statement to make at this time. I will not say another word. Executions are now likely to resume within a year. Another year. But a lawyer who challenged Prop 66, challenged it, said that the ruling will allow executions to resume at a faster pace. But the court struck down two constitutionally offensive parts of Prop 66, said one of the rotten, stinking left-wing attorneys, Christina von der Ach Rayburn, struck it down. Unbelievable to me. She said the justice should have invalidated the entire ballot measure. You hear this? Because the people should have no vote, should have no voice. This is sickening. Okay, I'm really, my heart is pounding right now. I wanted to have a good time today. But when I see violence emerging in America as it is, when I see people being marginalized and their cultural identity being spit upon with statues coming down and everyone who opposes a left-wing fanaticism called a Nazi, I'm telling you, there's only a few places left for people to go. And the worst of it are these judges. They think that they're God's almighty. They think that they're above the law. Do you have any idea what they just did? California has the nation's largest death row with 750 inmates. Half of them have been there for at least 20 years. Appeals of death sentence verdicts now take more than 20 years to resolve. That's because the vermin in the legal profession have made that happen. Can you believe this? Crime victims groups back Prop 66. That is people who were murdered, the survivors. And prosecutors, they back 66. And they told voters that the measure would cut that period in half by requiring faster court action. But this is what's going on. This is sickening. Who filed this against the people who passed it? Well, I don't even want to read it. You can read it yourself. All I can say to you is the reason that I am in favor of the death penalty, and don't tell me about Spain or Portugal. I'm not interested in Spain or Portugal. I live in the United States of America. I'm not interested in the wobblies of Europe and what they do in their law. As far as I'm concerned, they have no law. It's a lawless state, Europe. A bunch of Nazis ran over Europe. They can't even protect their own people from the Muslim invaders. Don't tell me what I should think. Don't tell me and lecture me. Because I have to be the last man standing, I'll be the last man standing in this state. Okay. I said what I had to say. Dalton Henderson stole Prop 209. He's still around, laughing at you, mocking you, making a mockery of you, the ACLU. I told you how to save this nation. You have to start with the lawyers. I told you that. I told Donald Trump that. He never heard me. I send emails, I don't get an answer, but I told him that the ACLU has to go. The ACLU has to be investigated under RICO statutes. For that matter, all the funding of Black Lives Matter and Antifa has to be investigated under RICO statutes and find out where the money is coming from, as you would in any case involving gangs. And once you find the funding, you arrest those who are supplying the money. You cut it off. You know where it all goes, don't you? You know where most of it comes from? Do you know how many different terrorist left-wing groups in America are funded under various nice-sounding names by George Soros and his front groups and him and his good son, little Soros, the mini-me Soros, sitting up there in his big tower up there in Manhattan, enjoying all of the beauties of America, all of the protections of America while fostering hatred, fostering division, fostering civil war by funding these groups? Do you know how many different names of groups there are? I have them all in Trump's war. They're listed in three pages. That's how bad this is.
I'll be right back.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282.
Savage.
The Savage Nation is sponsored by Swiss America, the only company I trust with my financial future. Call 800-289-2646 or SwissAmerica.com. Welcome back. It's Friday. You know what I mean? Lighten up a little bit. Now, you know, if I really wanted to get angry, I would say that we should start a recall petition for the California State Supreme Court justices who overrode the ballot initiative that the people passed. That should be the next ballot initiative. So then let's say it passes after two hard years, and it says the three judges who overrode the ballot initiative the last time shall be removed. So then it goes back to these five stinkers again. And the same three say, well, shall is only a suggestion, not a directive. So we'll stay on a little while longer. Well, now you understand how revolutions occur. You understand what's going on in this country. You think that only Antifa is angry? You ain't seen nothing yet. You have not yet seen the average law-abiding, tax-paying American rise up. He will. I'm telling you right now, it's going to happen if this keeps up. The more that the rights of the middle class are stolen, the more that our culture is spit upon, the more the statues are pulled down, the more that the children are taught that being white is evil. I'm warning you, you're stirring up a civil war. And of course, that's why these people are doing it. They want civil war. In 2014, I published a book called Stop the Coming Civil War, Not Start the Coming Civil War. And I warned America that a civil war was brewing. Obama had spent the years before that stirring up race hatred, class hatred, anything he could do to stay in power. He knew that you can divide and conquer very easily. Him and his whole team followed the Alinsky strategy, and they divided America. We are now seeing the whirlwind that he sowed. And the question is, how do we calm it down? Well, I did a show the other day called We Can Be Enemies Without Enmity. There is more hatred now from the left than I have seen at any time in my life. I've seen anger before. I've never seen such hatred before. And you have to ask yourself where this hatred is coming from. It certainly has nothing to do with social injustice. It has to do with psychopathology and drugs. Drugs are now more rampant in American society, especially the most evil of all drugs, marijuana, than ever before. And I would wager that most of those wearing the masks and throwing the bricks are stoned out of their minds. They are the assassins of civilization. And we have a Department of Homeland Security that could do something to stop them. They could declare them a terrorist group. They could seek the funding. They could arrest those funding them, and that could be the end of it. Believe me, it ended overnight. Okay, I said my piece. I don't even want to get stuck on it. You know what I'm saying? I'd rather not get stuck on it if I could avoid it. I mean, it's Friday. I'm a human being, you know. Got to relax a little bit, too. So, you know, life goes on.
Savage.
Yesterday I did a show that was very popular. I know it was by your response. I made a list of offensive New York City neighborhood names that must be removed because they're offensive to the communists, because the stupid mayor, de Blasio, Sandinista lover, wants to remove statues of Columbus and such and rename Columbus Circle, I guess, to Sharpton Circle or something along those lines. Maybe, you know, something even more offensive than Al Sharpton he can pick. And tell us that it's not racist. But so I said, went down a list of New York neighborhoods and cities, city streets that are offensive and must be changed, such as, I said, Broadway. It's sexist, has to go because it's an archaic term for women. The Meatpacking District. Do I have to say it's clearly a homophobic slur? Time to go. Queens, another gay slur. Diker Heights, it's offensive to tall lesbians. Upper and Lower East Side have to go because we can't imply there are different classes. We're all equal, right? There's no upper and lower anything. Now, if you live in Flushing, New York, it's unfair to people in other countries who do not have indoor plumbing. And if they've just come here from Somalia, for example, they may feel oppressed by the name of the city Flushing. So that has to go. Fordham, gone, has the word ham in it, offensive to Muslims. Crown Heights suggests royalty, which we all know, well, slaves, royalty. Chinatown, racist against Asians. Now, Little Italy is offensive not only to Italians, but to short people also. It has to go. Stuyvesant Town, racist Peter Stuyvesant stole Manhattan from the natives, has to go. You get the picture, right? Do I have to continue? It's on michaelsavage.com. And finally, we get to Ozone Park, offensive to environmentalists, has to go. Little Neck makes fun of a person's deformity. I think that's very funny. I have some new names that Jim put together today. Paradise. Now, there's Paradise Valley in Arizona. There's Paradise Drive in California. There are many cities and states and towns with the name Paradise in it. And I think all references to Paradise obviously have to go because Paradise as a word is offensive to Islamofascists who believe that they need to kill to get there. And for you to be living in a place without having killed, do you realize how offensive that is to the Islamofascists in the world? Haight-Ashbury has to go. There's no room for hate in America. Russian Hill, offensive to Clinton supporters for obvious collusion with Trump. Russian Hill has to be stricken. Tenderloin District, that is clearly offensive to vegans in San Francisco. Now, in Oregon, you've got Mount Hood. Do I have to tell you that that's an obvious reference to the Ku Klux Klan? That the mountain itself, Mount Hood, was named for the Ku Klux Klan? Don't you see that? Can't you see the world through the eyes of the girls who go to college today? Great Smoky Mountains, goner. Because why? It's insensitive to those suffering from secondhand smoke inhalation. You don't want to encourage smoking, do you? You're going to take your kids to see the Great Smoky Mountains? The kid will say, well, Mommy, what's smoke? The White House, do I have to tell you why that has to go? Old Faithful. Now, that's a tricky one because it implies that we're judging by age. And I think Old Faithful has to go and be changed just simply to unfaithful. Notre Dame has to go because it's a slur against women. It's an old slur against women. Notre Dame, are you kidding? Hershey, Pennsylvania has to go. It may be offensive to diabetics. Bourbon Street, do I have to tell you that's insensitive to those afflicted with alcoholism? So get rid of that. You see where this is going, Mayor de Blasio? Mayor de Blasio, if you had any brains, well, I would say his brains are equal to his conscience, okay? They're about equal. Here's a little side note. You know the guy who's running France now, the Rothschild Bank frontman, France Macron, who defeated the wonderful right-wing woman who could have saved France from the Muslim invasion? Well, France's Macron spent 24,000 pounds, no, 24,000 euros on makeup in 3 months. You talk about fake politicians. President Emmanuel Macron's office has confirmed reports that the French leader spent $30,000 on makeup during the first 3 months in power and says it's trying to find a cheaper alternative. But it gets even better. Remember the socialist dunce who ran France before him? Hollande, remember him, that dunce? Macron's makeup expenses are lower than those of predecessor François Hollande, who paid a full-time makeup artist 10,000 euros monthly. You talk about excess. It always comes worse from the left than the right. Everything doesn't have to be political. There are natural causes of things that have nothing to do with politics. But you can't tell that to fools. You know, dealing with fools is dealing with fools. So what am I going to talk about, a storm? Let's talk about the storm. Life-threatening rainfall expected in Texas, says Hurricane Center on the Extreme Weather Channel. Well, I hope they're wrong. You know, there was a time in history when in Sweden, I believe it is, the ice, we're talking about the Little Ice Age in the Middle Ages. Many of you liberals don't know there was a little ice age. You didn't get that at Harvard. But in the Little Ice Age, ice was actually aggressing onto regions of Europe and other places, and it was coming down into the valleys of Sweden, the ice. It was increasing because the Earth had gone into a Little Ice Age rather than a warming phase. It went into a cooling phase as we are in now. And there are reports that priests held up crosses and walked to the edges of the glaciers and tried to do an incantation against the glacier to keep it from moving further into the civilized areas. Would you believe that? Well, maybe Trump can go there now and stand there and try to fend off the storm. Maybe that would make the liberal Bolsheviks happy. Leave the guy alone already. Who can manage this country? Do you actually think there's anyone on earth who can manage the United States of America being as broken as it is? You know, that's a bigger question than any. I haven't actually thought about that. Patrick Buchanan wrote a fabulous article. He's such a brilliant guy. He wrote What Still Unites Us. It's a fabulous article. It's on patbuchanan.com. And I don't want to quote the whole thing, but he is really right on when he writes this thing. He says, against what the neocons, traditionalists, argued, that while America was uniquely great, the nation was united by faith, culture, language, history, heroes, holidays, mores, manners, customs, and traditions. A common feature of Americans, black and white, was pride in belonging to a people that had achieved so much. And then he says, the insight attributed to Alexis de Tocqueville, that America is great because she is good, and if America ceases to be good, she will cease to be great, was a belief shared by almost all. And then Pat writes that what makes our future appear problematic is that what once united us now divides us. While Presidents Wilson and Truman declared us to be a Christian nation, Christianity has been purged from our public life and sheds believers every decade. Atheism and agnosticism are growing rapidly, especially among the young. Traditional morality grounded in Christianity is being discarded. Half of all marriages end in divorce. 4 in 10 children are born out of wedlock. Unrestricted abortion and same-sex marriage, once regarded as marks of decadence and decline, are now seen as human rights and the hallmarks of social progress. Tens of millions of us do not speak English. Where most of our music used to be classic, popular, country and western and jazz, much of it now contains rutting lyrics that used to be unprintable. I like that, rutting lyrics. Where we used to have 3 national networks, we have 3 24-hour cable news channels and 1,000 websites that reinforce our clashing beliefs on morality, culture, politics, and race. That's very interesting stuff. Consider what's happened since Charlottesville. The word murderer was painted on the San Fernando statue of Father Junipero Serra, the Franciscan who founded the missions that became San Diego, San Francisco, San Juan Capistrano, and Santa Clara. America's oldest monument honoring Columbus in Baltimore was vandalized. Senator Tim Kaine of Virginia called for Robert E. Lee's statue to be removed from Capitol and replaced by Pocahontas. No, I don't want to read any more of this insanity. So I'm asking you a question related to this. Hillary Clinton, as you know, described you and I, this segment of America that listens to this program and others like it, as deplorables, who are racist, sexist, homophobic, xenophobic, Islamophobic, and bigots. She said we are irredeemable. That's what she did. So who can rule this country and bring us together? Do you think there is anyone on the American political landscape, anyone at all, who can bring us together, unite us? You know, Hillary couldn't have done anything for this country but divide. You know, have you thought about where we'd be 9 months into a Hillary regime? Have you thought about the assaults on the First Amendment, the Second Amendment, the Third Amendment, the Fourth Amendment? Have you thought about how your children in this country would be running in fear for being white as the hatred would have amped up under Hillary? This hatred of white people would have amped up, not amped down. So I don't know that Trump is as bad as the left says, by the way. I'm not going to say he's a great man because it's never been about him for me. Have I ever told you that? Well, let me stand up and tell you that. It was never about Donald Trump for me. I didn't know the man. It was about his ideas, which were mine. His ideas that he discussed, he mirrored during the campaign were almost identical to mine on borders, language, and culture. After all, who wrote as many books as I did, spelling out as completely and as carefully as I did the entire strategy of Donald Trump? Nobody. He even said, without this man, I wouldn't be president. He said it in front of the entire crowd of people at Mar-a-Lago, and I thank him for it. I'm sure he meant it when he said it, because I didn't hear him say it about anyone else. I was very proud of that moment. And when I went up to him and I told him I was a certain age, you know what he said? He said, you need another 25 years. The country needs you. Well, that was beautiful. So it was never about the man. It was about the ideas that he ran down the field with. I want to know what other person on the stage, man or woman, could unite this nation. Can you give me an example of someone who could bring this country together? Bernie Sanders is going to bring it together, that demagogue, the seltzer man. Hillary Clinton's finished. She's never going to win again. All they're doing on the Democrat side is seeing who can go further to the left. Left, 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 left. And they're going to be left out of the political discussion because they're losing the entire center of this country. So let me ask you again, who can bring this country together? So before you say Trump is that evil, because now there's a mass hysteria on this issue. It's a hysteria that I've never seen in my lifetime, with a piling on along the lines of pulling down the statues. Who could unite this country and bring it together? The morons who say they're going to run. I love it. Every moronic sports figure now, kid this and Schmendrick that, he's going to run. He's going to be president now. Every putz is going to run for the. Actors are going to run. Actors are going to run. Sports figures are. They're not going to win. What they don't understand is they're so stupid, these people. They're figuring, oh, if Donald Trump could win, why anyone could win? Well, they're wrong. They don't understand something, which is the fundamental of Trump's victory. Trump didn't win because he's Trump. Trump won because he had ideas that resonated with enough people. So you get a moron actor on the left, he's going to run because he's a famous actor. But he has no ideas to run with. What are his ideas? I'm beautiful. He's not going to win. The left's not going to support him. The middle's not going to support him. Nothing. It's a self-aggrandizement. Only someone with the right ideas can win.
Be right back.
Join the Savage Nation. Call now, 855-400-SAVAGE, 855-400-7282. Savage.
The Savage Nation is sponsored by Swiss America, the only company I trust with my financial future. Call 800-289-2646 or SwissAmerica.com. Stench from the bench is making me clench. This great nation of ours is being torn apart by the vermin on the left. They want us to be ashamed. They want us to be sick of our own nation. They want those of us who are not of color to hate ourselves. The left has a rage that I've never seen in my life. Where it is coming from is, well, you could put two and two together. It's being taught in the schools. It's being funded by very, very evil people. There is also a huge, huge relationship to the prevalence of marijuana, which brings out violence in people, and they don't even know it. You don't know it, I don't know it, but the very same man, George Soros, who is funding many of these left-wing groups, was the first one to introduce the idea that there should be a thing called medical marijuana legalized. I remember fighting it in 1998. He spent $1 million in Arizona and California to push legalized marijuana, and I said, well, if it works against pain and diseases, well, then keep it as a drug. Isolate the compounds in the cannabis plant that are therapeutic and use them as medicines. But it was never about medicine. Never. I saw from the get-go what Soros wanted. He wanted to drug an entire generation in order to manipulate them, make them more murderous, in my estimation, make them more like the assassins whose name itself, assassins, comes from the drug that was used and may still be used by Arab assassins, hashish. Yes, the word hashish, hassassin, the same root word in Arabic. People become extremely violent on the cannabis. They may not know it. That's what makes them even more dangerous. But in tearing down our nation, they are assassinating our nation. And so, just to continue with Pat Buchanan's article, What Still Unites Us, he says, to another slice of America, much of the celebrated social and moral progress of recent decades induces a sense of nausea. Hillary Clinton famously described us, this segment of America, as a basket of deplorables, that we are racist, sexist, homophobic, xenophobic, Islamophobic bigots, and we're irredeemable. Now, I got to pause at that for a reason. In the Soviet Union during the 1930s, prior to the execution of millions of people and the enslavement of millions of Russians by fellow Russians, they were first defamed like this. The farmers who were providing the wheat and the food for all of Russia were minor capitalists at the time. They raised the crops through great, great labor and great risk, and they sold the crops and made a small profit. Stalin came along and started a smear campaign, a propaganda campaign, calling them kulaks, which was an offensive term, maybe along the lines of cracker, or worse yet. He called all farmers kulaks, and that started the campaign against them. And eventually the farmers were taken off their own land. The land was seized by the government. And the so-called kulaks were enslaved in slave labor camps or executed outright. You're witnessing a stage of a revolution in this country along the lines of the revolution against the landowners of Russia, the farmers, or against the landowners that we saw killed and mutilated in South Africa, worse yet in Rhodesia, Zimbabwe. You know any about that? Anything about that? Because that's what's going on in this country. If this is not stopped, you're going to see what happened in South Africa or in Rhodesia in this country, as sure as I'm sitting here. And so I ask you again, when you have haters like Hillary Clinton and Mario de Blasio stirring up hatred for the middle class, which is what they are doing, who can unite this nation? What can hold us together? What can still make us a nation? I don't know the answer. What can bring us together? Who can bring us together? It's anyone's guess what anyone really wants. I know what I want. I want law and order. I want peace and stability. I want my nation back. It's that simple. Who can bring us together? I don't know who can. You have any ideas? Sean, line 9.
Savage.